Hey everyone, Amy Bowser Tennant, the Genealogy Reporter, and it is Genealogy Tip Tuesday. Oh, we are here to talk about New Mexico today. I am super excited. I have not had the chance to do a lot of Southwest United States research until lately, and I'm excited to share with you what I've learned. My eldest daughter, who is adopted, one of her birth family lines reaches well and far back into New Mexico. And so we were doing some recent family research there, and I learned some things I wanted to share with you. I think if you have lines that reach into the Southwest, this will be helpful to you. So what you need to know at first is that there are five main time periods, and understanding those time periods are going to help you better locate the records that you need, because you're going to understand where the records might be kept or what jurisdiction they might be held under. Okay, so first we begin in 1598 to about the year 1821. That is considered colonial Spain. In other words, the area of New Mexico today would have been under Spanish rule. Then 1821 to about 1846, the Mexican government had ownership or control over that area. Now, between 1846 and 1850, which was really kind of just a short amount of time there, the U.S. had control, and that was that large area was considered a U.S. territory. And that territory actually covers what today we know as New Mexico, parts of Arizona, parts of Mexico, all the way up stretching into parts of today's Colorado and Nevada. Now, in 1850, within the New Mexican territory, counties started being formed. So that is really important that you keep up on those boundary changes, know when and who was in charge so that you can find the records that you're looking for. Catholic Church records are huge in the New Mexican research area. I was really surprised. I haven't done a lot of Catholic Church records research, but they were fantastic. We've got baptisms, christenings, sacramental records, including marriages, deaths, last rites, these types of things. Now, you do need to realize that while researching in New Mexico, you're often going to run into records that are written in Spanish. But don't let that deter you. Just pop that right into Google Translate and let Google Translate help you determine what those Spanish records are saying. One of the things I noticed too about baptismal records, and not all of them, just some of them, included not only the infant's name and the parents and the godparents and the witnesses, but sometimes the grandparents. And so in some cases, this one document might give you three generations of persons. That's pretty good, okay? One document, three generations, not too shabby at all. I think the most unique record set were the prenuptial investigations. They were by far the most colorful. I will give them that. What it was is that the Catholic Church was looking for impediments that may keep a bride and groom from marrying. Typically, they were too closely related. So if there was a question about that, this prenuptial investigation would include the Catholic priest interviewing them, learning out who their parents were, maybe requesting baptismal service certificates from the place of their baptism or christening, and then making a determination of their closeness and whether or not they could be legally married. So I wanted to look through these records. They sounded fascinating, and I found them on the New Mexico Genealogical Society webpage. I'm going to put a link to that in the video description below. But there you're going to find an abstract or transcribed copy of these prenuptial investigations. They start as early as 1760. They're in PDF format, so they can be downloaded. I did a quick search for the surnames that landed in my daughter's family tree. And one of those surnames was Garuli. And I found who I'm just gonna say 90% sure are her either fifth or sixth set of grandparents. I got to do a little bit more work on that just to make sure, but the names do look quite familiar and the place and time frame is about right. So I'm going to read this record to you. In the prenuptial investigations, the year was 1804. So here's what the record said. Francisco Guruli, over 30, Quixote, was the legitimate son of Ignacio Guruli and Melchora Gertes, both deceased. That mention of him being a Quixote, that is a racial distinction in Mexico Catholic records. And I reached out to my good friend and colleague, Colleen Green, who is excellent at Mexican research, and she sent me a link to Family Search Wiki in which there were numerous racial designations used in Catholic records in Mexico. And so I will put a link to that in the description below because I think that might help you out as well. The record continues by saying, Maria Barbara Sanchez, age 21, mestiza. Now that means that she was of Native American mix along with Spanish. So European native mix. That's interesting. Was the legitimate daughter of Juan Domingo Sanchez and Simona Chavez. All were citizens of San Antonio in Belen jurisdiction. In Belen, Father Bernal questioned Francisco. He stated that he and Maria Barbara were related in the second degree of affinity as a result of carnal relations he had with her first cousin, Maria Manuela Arroyo. He had also caused his intended to lose her virginity after promising to marry her. He added that he lived in the area for more than 20 years. Maria Barbara stated that they were not related and that she was a lifelong resident of that jurisdiction. So, fascinating little story there. Little mischief seems to be going on there with Francisco Guruli. And then they have a list of witnesses. Now, these witnesses' names, just like so many times, witnesses can often be family members. So that is something that will draw our attention. But also, they have this little chart of a family tree trying to portray how they are related, how this bride and groom are related. And they have down here Maria Barbara Sanchez. That would be the bride and her first cousin, Maria Manuela Arroyo. And then their mothers, which are Simona Chavez and Maria Gertrude Chavez, their sisters. And then their mother's name is Juana. And it says right next to her name, Kiowa Indian. Now, this is very interesting because so many times we will have in our DNA results, as my daughter does, a Native American component, and they can't tell us what Native American tribe are, you know, we're from, okay? DNA can't quite pinpoint it, but paperwork can. And in my daughter's case, if this is accurate, as I think it might be, so I got to do a little more digging, I can now say that through the paper, this Juana, a Kiowa Indian from the New Mexican area, is at least one of the persons in the Native American tribe that my daughter descends from. And so I found that connection, that Native American tribe connection, at least in one family line. I thought that was really interesting. So take a look at some of these things, especially I would encourage you to visit the New Mexico Genealogical Society webpage. They have a lot of great things on there, as well as FamilySearch.org has many records that you can see, original records, for free. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel. And remember that subscribing to our channel is free. So go ahead and click that button. We look forward to seeing you again. Thanks, everyone, and have a great day. Bye-bye.